be a lot higher.
Do it in our
Why do they make the kids go to Idaho?
Oh, yeah, he's going to get ready. Like, you're going to see him again.
Do it in Ann Arbor.
Yeah. Oh, come on, man. That's what we do.
All right, to the Celtics. It's been a rough 24 hours for Boston. For one, Kyrie Irving is not expected to rejoin the team, and all signs seemingly point to him joining the Nets. And to make matters worse, Al Horford is also expected to turn down his player option and seek a multi-year deal elsewhere. Vince, what do you make of this Celtics situation?
Danny Ainge overplayed his hand for a very long time. He thought, okay, I can bring in Kyrie Irving and extend this sort of period of, I don't have to go all in. I can leverage some of these assets, quote unquote assets, and not look at them as players and treat them as such. And I think it wound up backfiring on him. From putting Kyrie in a leadership position without the support from a organizational standpoint, I don't think they supported him and gave him people to connect with to show him how to be a leader. They just thought that some of that LeBron magic would wear off on him, and it did not. Mm-hmm. And now you have all these disgruntled young players, and you have a veteran in Al Horford who's like, you know what? I got X amount of years left. I'm in my early 30s. I'm not going to take a hometown discount for a team that's not going to compete for a championship if we're being realistic.
Yep.
I better take this money while I can. He's had injury histories over the past 3 or 4 years. And when we find out where he goes, that's going to say a lot about what the Celtics are as an organization.
And emotionally, we didn't talk much about it, but this season had to be harder on Al Horford than anybody on that team. Al Horford was, as you mentioned earlier, see, a two-time champion at the University of Florida. Won a championship, and then he and that whole crew, Joe Kim Noah, Corey Brewer, said, you know what, we're going to come back and try to do it again, and they did it. And he got to the NBA and was an excellent player, was on a 60-win Atlanta team, maybe the best player on that Atlanta team, and ran into LeBron, and then got to Boston and ran into LeBron. And then last year, LeBron's gone. Kyrie's healthy. Hayward's back. And this is the year I, Al Horford, make my first NBA Finals. And what? We're the fourth or fifth best team in the conference all year long. We win our first five playoff games and then fall flat on our face. It couldn't have left a worse taste in anyone's mouth other than Horford. So it makes sense that he would leave, especially with Mark Stein's report. Someone's getting ready to offer him 4 years, $100 million. But on the Danny Ainge point, it's amazing to me, the guy that played in the 80s has been around this league for the entirety of my life, that he doesn't know something that is so obvious to everyone else. To make the NBA Finals, to win a championship, you have to have not an all-star, not a nice team, not a good supporting cast, superstars. Magic, Bird, Isaiah, Jordan, Akeem, Shaq, Duncan, Kobe, LeBron, Steph. Those 10 guys, at least one of them, has been in 40 consecutive NBA Finals. You got one of those guys? Okay, if not, you're drawn dead. And the problem for them, and the reason why Danny Ainge should be criticized, is unlike many teams, they had so many bites at the apple at getting a guy like that. You could have traded for Kawhi. Mm-hmm. You could have traded for Anthony Davis. You could have traded for Paul George. You could have traded for Blake Griffin. You could have traded for Boogie Cousins. You could have. Instead, Terry Rozier was untouchable, and then Jaylen Brown's untouchable. Mm-hmm. And now, of course, Jason Tatum's untouchable. And those three players combined all set their career all-star games at 2.5 and take the under. So, okay, that's your plan moving forward, which is not a plan moving forward.
Wasn't it reported last week Danny Ainge had an opportunity to trade for Kawhi Leonard?
Yeah.
But he wouldn't include who?
Jaylen Brown. Yeah.
You know what ends up happening? Danny Ainge, he played himself.
Mm-hmm.
You know? That's what they say on the street. You straight played yourself. in believing that Kyrie Irving, even though he demanded a trade out of Cleveland, Boston wasn't one of the teams he demanded to go to. So Danny Ainge and the organization said, you know, if we bring him here in our culture, we can win him over. We're going to go out and get Gordon Hayward. We already got Al Horford. We got some young players. Like, this is a championship atmosphere. Kyrie Irving's getting ready to go out the door. Al Horford's going out the door with no compensation. So regardless of what they say, those two veteran players, one with championship experience, Al Horford, a world-class guy and has championship experience in college, they're going out saying, hey, other free agents, don't come to Boston. That's what they're saying. So the message, man, the Boston, they're going to have a perception problem around the league, because if they don't draft you, who's going to come to Boston? And I'm just going to go on history. I've been long, live enough, Nick, longer than yourself. Not a whole bunch of great basketball players are signing up to go play for the Boston Celtics. That has been consistent decade after decade.
Yeah, they got Gordon Hayward. If go back to that overflowing well of max level players who played for Brad Stevens in college and get another one. Oh, wait, they don't exist. They got Al Horford in a weak free agency year, and he left at his first opportunity. Not picking up my option, and I am gone. Like, their only path was to take the bounty they got from Brooklyn and turn it into stars. Because the other sneaky truth about the Celtics is, haven't drafted great. Drafted well, and I will give them credit, Jason Tatum. They saw they had the number one pick. They could move back and still get the player they wanted. It was a great move. And individually, Danny Ainge always wins the transaction.
Absolutely.
Always wins the transaction. Absolutely. But if you are only going to bet on 80-20 favorites, you're never going to win big. And that's been the problem for them, is sometimes you have to run the risk, I might lose this transaction. I might trade Jaylen Brown for Kawhi Leonard. Jaylen Brown blossoms into his best possible potential. Kawhi doesn't get healthy, and he walks. Or maybe you pair Kawhi and Kyrie, and you win the title.
Yeah, look at the risk that Golden State took. 73 wins. We can go sign Durant with Draymond, that explosive. Steph might be offended, and Klay, man, who knows what Klay is thinking. But that was a chance that they took. Kawhi last year, man, they cashed it all in. Right now in the NBA, it's hard to win if you don't take a chance.
Well, scared money don't make money is what they say. And the problem with Danny is, with getting Garnett and Allen, it was a blue block special, basically. He got that deal from Kevin McHale, his buddy in Boston.
A homie hookup.
The hookup. Jeff Green for Ray Allen, boom, you win that trade. And then with the Brooklyn trade, you win that resoundingly. As soon as it happened, everybody could say, you know what, Boston made out like bandits. The problem is you feel like you have to come away with that type of advantage every single time. And you believe that you are smarter than everybody else all the time, and that, you know what, not only would my players be able to play because they're playing for their contracts, they're playing for their futures, that it won't hamper them or affect them, that also I'll be able to get the maximum value for the perfect superstar at the right time. And Danny Ainge, actually, like you said, he played himself. And here's the other part of it. I'm not sure if Danny Ainge has the right people as far as around him, executives and in the coaching staff, that can connect with today's players. When you can connect with Kevin Garnett easy, because he wants to win. He's one-track minded. Mm-hmm. You can connect with veterans 10, 11, 12 years in that are desperate to win, that don't have a lot of frills. But to connect with a guy like Kyrie Irving, who's a little bit more difficult, who's a little bit more nuanced, who's a little bit more flighty, you need different types of people on your coaching staff that he can connect with. And that was something that I've been long hearing, that Kyrie didn't feel like he had any connection with anybody in that Boston Celtics organization.
And 6 years after that Nets heist, the Nets in about 2 weeks will be in far better position than the Boston Celtics are. And the one piece that they traded for that of their Nets bounty was for Kyrie Irving, who now almost assuredly is going to go play for the Nets and not the Celtics.
Hey, if you could have any player in the NBA or Brad Stevens, who would you have?
Oh, I remember that question. My man Chris Mannix put that up on Twitter. Why you got to roast Mannix like that? He ain't here to defend himself.
Vince, we're going to see you a little later in the show. Coming up, to the Lakers need a third star to have a chance at a title. That's next on First Things First.
Hey, Mannix here tomorrow. Let's put that tweet on a full screen.
Oh, no, we're going to have hashtag played yourself.
Poor Mannix.